Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm so glad that you are here this morning, and I hope that you've come ready to worship together, and that you're ready to praise God and all that with us this morning. So this morning we're going to start off the service a little bit different than what we normally would do. We're going to have a responsive reading time out of Psalms 85. So what's going to happen is our praise team is going to say something, and then we as a congregation, we're going to read in response. And all of the words that we're going to read are going to be up on the screen, so we'll just follow along as they go.
You, Lord, showed favor to your land. You restored the fortunes of Jacob. You forgave the iniquity of your people and covered all their sins.
You set aside all your wrath and turned from your fierce anger.
Restore us again, God our Savior, and put away your displeasure toward us.
Will you be angry with us forever? Will you prolong your anger through all generations?
Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? Show us your unfailing love, Lord, and grant us your salvation.
I will listen to what God the Lord says. He promises peace to his people, his faithful servants, but let them not turn to folly.
Surely his salvation is near those who fear him, that his glory may dwell in our land.
Love and faithfulness meet together. Righteousness and peace kiss each other.
Faithfulness springs forth from the earth, and righteousness looks down from heaven.
Would you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this morning tonight. Thank you that we are able to come and worship you. And I pray, God, that you would open our hearts and that you would speak to us this morning, and that we would respond back to you, and that we would leave today a little bit closer to you, and that our lives would be changed. Be with us this morning. In your name, amen.
Amen. Will you stand with us and sing Shout to the North? Now we're going to do it a little differently. Verse 2, the women are singing to the men of faith. We'll just do the best. Why don't we just have everybody sing? Not that anybody wants to sing solo. Here we go.
To the east and the west, Jesus is Savior too.
You may be seated real quick. So a couple of announcements, like, so that you know what's going on in the life of our church. The first thing that I want to just pass along again to you is to remind you, one, to be praying, but also that Pastor Jim has started his sabbatical. And for the next few months, he'll be, that he won't be with us, but it's a time for him to be able to rest and recover over the past several years of all the craziness that's gone on. But I just want to remind you that we as a congregation, we have a responsibility to help him on the sabbatical. And the two best ways that we can help him is, one, is that to be praying for him. Just because he's not here doesn't mean that we shouldn't be praying for him. And secondly, that we can leave him alone. That we don't need to be calling him and all of that, because I know that Pastor Jim, he deeply cares for all of us, and if we're calling him all the time, which he probably would want that, but then he's not going to get the rest he needs. So if you have questions or emergencies come up, contact Judy Arndt. All her contact information is in the bulletin, and she will get you in contact with the right person who needs to take care of all of that. So if anything comes up, prayer requests, emergencies, anything like that, contact Judy and she will help you get into contact with the right person. Then also, I just want to kind of mention that the district's women's retreat, there's a flyer in your bulletin. So if you're interested in that, take a look at that, because I know for our teenagers and for our kids, it was a great opportunity to go up to Golden Bound and get a break from life. And it's a good opportunity to reconnect with God and go a little bit deeper with him. So if you're interested, see the flyer in your bulletin. All right, so we will go ahead and move on to our next worship song. Oh, that's right, I forgot. We're going to move into our offering time. So I'll invite Aaron to come up and pray over our offering.
Can't forget the offering, can we? Okay, you'll find the offering plates here on each side of the building and on the back. And so let's pray. Lord Jesus, we're so grateful for this time when we can give back to you a portion of what you have blessed us with. And we just thank you that we can come to this place of meeting where we can celebrate and pray for each other and be aware of the needs that are around us right here in our church and around the world. And we just thank you, Lord, that we can be a part of giving back to you. And I pray that we would be generous givers and ask for your guidance and direction as the leaders of our church make the decisions of our finances. And we just pray your blessing upon our church. And I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Our next song is called Revive Us Again. And as our scripture said, will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you? So will you sing with us the song, Revive Us Again?
Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen.
our prayer indeed that God will revive us, allow us to sense His presence and His Spirit within us. We do want to go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Just want to remind you of some of the prayer requests. I know that Bailey mentioned, of course, we need to be praying for a pastor, and that certainly needs to be one of the priorities of us over this next couple months as pastors on sabbatical. We'd be praying for him. We also want to be praying for the people of Haiti who've had a horrible earthquake taking place there. I don't know if you've seen that news, but it came yesterday, and there are many lives lost once again. And you know, almost as if to add pain to injury, it looks like there's a hurricane that's heading towards Haiti even now as we speak. And so we just need to be praying for God's protection among these people there. Another horrible tragedy that's taken place there. We also want to be praying for Charlotte's grandfather, who's passed away this past week, and want to be lifting up Charlotte and the rest of the family. There's a wonderful comfort that comes, though, when a great man of God goes to the Lord. And so Paul reminds us that it is this time of mourning, but we don't mourn like those who don't have hope. And we give thanks to God for that kind of encouragement He gives to us. We also just need to be praying for our church. We've had one of our members who's tested positive for COVID this last week, and her husband's sick as well, and they think that he has it also. So we just need to be lifting them up, and just praying for protection of our church and our community and our city and our nation and our world. How far can you go, right? Not far enough with that. So, but you know, one thing we were talking about in Sunday school this morning is that one of the things that comforts us during this time is that we go to a God who loves us, who cares for us, who's the Creator God. And so we don't go into prayers just with wishful thinking. We're going to the source of it all, God the Father, who loves us and cares for us. So let's go to Him in prayer this morning, shall we? Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for who You are, and we're reminded once again of Your great compassion, Your love, Your mercy. And we see that in so many things around us. But we see this, I think, most highly and most clearly in the presence of Jesus Himself. And Father, it always amazes me and humbles me to recognize that You loved us so much, that You love us so much. That You didn't just send us another angel or a prophet or someone to speak to us, but as the writer of Hebrew tells us, that You came Yourself. You came Yourself. And in Jesus, Father, then we see Your love, we see Your concern, we see Your involvement in the lives of people just like us. And so, Father, this morning as we come into Your presence, we want to give You thanks and praise for who You are. We want to thank You for Your love. We want to thank You for the fact that You're not only the great Creator God with all power, but You're a God who loves us and cares for us. And so, Father, as we come to You and we give You our thanks, and we give You our praise, as we bring our needs and requests to You, then we come as children to their Father, who know that the Father cares, who loves, who invites them to come and sit beside Him and to share what's on our heart. And so, Father, we do bring to You our thanksgiving and praise. Thank You for inviting us to Your presence. Thank You for making that possible through Jesus Christ. And thank You, Father, for lovingly hearing us and caring for us. Father, we ask that You would please be with the people of Haiti right now, who are struggling through yet another earthquake and the loss of hundreds of lives, and they're still going through rubble, finding people. And Lord, we just ask for Your comfort, for Your protection, Your strength upon them. Lord, I pray that You would swerve a hurricane out of their way during these days, because that's not what they need on top of this other tragedy. Just protect them in a special way. And Father, we know there are quite a few Nazarenes who are in Haiti, and we'd ask that You would use them in a special way to reach out in love and in help to the people around them. Would You give them comfort themselves in the loss of property and lives? But do be with the people of Haiti, Lord, even this morning as we pray. Sometimes it seems like they're so far away, and yet they're not, because these are people who are created in Your image just like we are. And so our hearts and prayers and thoughts go out to them. And would You bless them in a special way? Lord, we pray for the COVID that's coming around and seems to be spiking up again. We'd ask for Your protection. We pray for the family here in our church where they're struggling with this right now, and ask for a speedy recovery on their behalf. We pray, Father, for Your protection upon people who are struggling with COVID. We pray for Your protection that we can stay away from this, Father, that You would protect our church from
from having more cases of COVID coming upon us. We just ask, Father, for your help in this. We pray, Lord, that you would protect our nurses and doctors who are the ones who are working so closely with those who have contracted this illness. We'd ask, Lord, that you would keep them safe as well, but do undertake in a special way. Lord, we pray you'd be with Sharla and her family and the loss of her grandfather. Thank you for this man, where Sharla was telling me he was in the ministry for over 60 years and using him to proclaim the good news of salvation through Jesus Christ and the reality of heart purity through holiness. And Father, I'd ask that as he's welcomed into the gates of heaven now, that you would allow that to be a great celebration, and you would comfort the hearts and minds of the family as they have a loved one that they miss. But Lord, we do give you thanks and praise. You be with them. And Father, we know there are others also who have lost loved ones. We think of Mr. Shim and the loss of Mrs. Shim and the loss of this actually in our own church of having a woman who's such a prayer warrior who is going before you on behalf of our church and our community and her family and the people around. Father, I pray that you would bring your comfort to the Shim family. Continue to do that and bless them in a special way. Father, we also pray you'd be with Ruth Kenyon, who's in the hospital right now. We'd ask that you would give her some comfort from the problems that she's facing and encourage her. Be with Herb as he's in the midst of all this and his thoughts and concern that goes out to his wife. Just bless this sweet couple in a special way, we'd ask, Lord. Lord, we also just bring our pastor to you. Would you bless him during this time of sabbatical? We thank you, Lord, for a pastor who works so hard and diligently and faithfully in the service to your kingdom and the service to us. We ask that during these weeks and months, Lord, that you would strengthen him, you'd encourage him, you'd inspire him, you'd help him to be rejuvenated, to recover from the many physical things that he's facing and some of the burdens that he carries with him as well. But just bless him in a special way. Pray you'd be with Zayda and help her and help Hannah and Sarah as they're involved in this as well, that you would be close to them and encourage them, allow this to be a special time for not only Jim himself, but for the entire family during these days and weeks. Lord, we also lift up our children and teens as they're, will be going back to school this week, if they've not already done that, depending upon the school district in which they're in. Lord, would you allow them to be beacons of light within the quarters and the classrooms of these different schools? I thank you, Lord, for the great protection you give to us through your Spirit. But sometimes, Father, I think that we pray so often for protection that we forget that you actually want to use us as your warriors, as your fierce warriors of righteousness within the world in which we live. We pray, Father, that you would do this through our children and through our teens, that you would certainly protect them from evil influences. But Father, you would allow them to be a light on a hill, that you'd allow them to be able to witness and to testify to the difference that Jesus makes in their life in a time where people seem to be so lost, so confused about so many things. But Lord, bless them in a special way. We also pray to be with our teachers who are back to work as well. We think of Kathy going back to her work and some of the unique circumstances she finds herself in after this past year. And we just ask whether this would be a blessing time for her, and you'd use her in a special way there, and just give her the confidence she needs within that. You know, we have other teachers as well. My daughter, Kimberly, who's teaching school, and ask you to be with her and protect her, and others that I perhaps don't know. But we do thank you, Lord, for our teachers and for the investment they place into our children. Would you protect them and lead them along a righteous path as well as they give instruction to the children. Lord, we thank you so much that in this service, as we come together, that your presence is here. You've invited us into your house. As we come together, then we know that your Spirit speaks to our hearts. So, Father, whether we're here in this sanctuary or whether we're at home watching this online, I'd ask, Lord, that we would sense your presence as we prepare ourselves to worship, that you would allow our hearts and minds to be open to the truths of the songs we're singing, the message we'll hear today, that Father, we'd be obedient to what you call us to do, be obedient to the people you call us to be. Thank you so much for your presence. Thank you so much for what you offer us this day. We look forward to what you're going to do in us and through us during this time. These things we pray in the name of Jesus.
The next song that we're singing is called Come to Jesus. So no matter what you're going through, what you're
Thank you so much, worship team. Really appreciate it. Kathy and Cindy and Carolyn and Sam, thank you so much. Really appreciate that a lot. If you have your Bibles, I'd like to invite you to turn to Jeremiah, prophet of the Old Testament. Pretty long prophet, so he's not very hard to find, Jeremiah. There's a passage here in chapter 5 that's always kind of captured my attention. There's some elements to this that are quite interesting and quite inspiring, and also some elements of this that are quite concerning and sobering. It's kind of interesting as, you know, I've preached quite a few times in my life, and there's certain sermons that are pretty easy to preach. They're fun to preach, and sometimes there's sermons that we preach and they're pretty hard to preach. And I think they're hard to preach sometimes because the Word of God can be rather confrontative to us sometimes. And I've realized as I get older that I need that sometimes too. And so this morning, as we look at Jeremiah and some of the implications of this, then I'm fully aware that these are words that I need to hear this morning as well. And the Lord speaking to me as well within the midst of this. And so I'd ask that as we look at this passage, that God will speak to each one of us and find us obedient and faithful in what he calls us to do and the response that we need to give to him. Okay? So if you have your Bibles, I'd like to invite you to turn to Jeremiah chapter 5. I'd like you to stand with me as we read from our Lord's Word this morning. Jeremiah chapter 5, verses 1 to 5. Go up and down the streets of Jeremiah. Excuse me, go up and down the streets of Jerusalem. I'm reading from Jeremiah. I'll get it right. Look around and consider. Search through her squares. If you can find but one person who deals honestly and seeks the truth, I will forgive this city. Although they say, as surely as the Lord lives, still they are swearing falsely. O Lord, do not your eyes look for truth? You struck them, but they felt no pain. You crushed them, but they refused correction. They made their faces harder than stone and refused to repent. I thought, these are only the poor. They are foolish, for they do not know the way of the Lord, the requirements of their God. So I will go to the leaders and speak to them. Surely they know the way of the Lord, the requirements of their God. But with one accord, they too had broken off the yoke and torn off the bonds. May the Lord bless this reading of his word. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, I pray that you would be with us as we pause by these words. Allow your spirit to speak to us just as he spoke to Jeremiah as he penned these words. Father, I pray that you would allow your spirit to convict us, to comfort us, to guide us in how we need to respond. And I pray that you would bless this time we have together. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Seated. Early in the 5th century BC, There lived a man whose name you probably heard or run into from time to time, depending upon the types of things you read. This man was a Greek philosopher, and he was actually a rather cynical philosopher. His name was Diogenes. Now, what Diogenes taught as a philosopher, or what he even thought as a philosopher, do not really make a whole lot of difference for us today. But Diogenes is better known for something that he did. He's known for a very peculiar search that he made while living in the ancient city of Athens. The search which Diogenes made is a search which I think that many people today are still making. Whether they're conscious of that or not, they're still making that kind of search. It's a search that confronts you and confronts me with some startling and sometimes not so comfortable questions. You see, Diogenes became notorious in Athens. For some reason that we do not know, Diogenes became obsessed with the question of morality. He became besieged with the issues of right and wrong and how people lived their lives. And so he began his search through the streets of Athens. And so in broad daylight, okay, not at night, in broad daylight, he could be seen carrying a lighted lantern. And as he passed any person along the street, he would thrust that lantern into their face, and he could be heard muttering these words as he would look into the eyes and explore the eyes of the face of the people of Athens. He would mutter, "I'm looking for an honest man. I'm looking for an honest person." History tells us that Diogenes never found that person. He never found him. Chapter 5 of Jeremiah is often called the Diogenes chapter, for it seems like the same kind of search was being conducted by Jeremiah. God instructs Jeremiah, go up and down the streets of Jerusalem, look around and consider. If you can find but one person who deals honestly and seeks the truth, I will forgive this city. Well, we've read the results of Jeremiah's search. Jeremiah found no one. He found no one. How hard could it have been to just find one person? Just one person who dealt with others honestly. One person who sought the truth. But among all the common people, the scripture tells us that Jeremiah found no one. And so he decided to look among the leaders then, the royal family, the king, the queen, the princes. He looked among the priestly line, the leaders, the teachers of the law. Once again, he found no one. Now, I have to be honest with you, this passage troubles me, and it troubles me a lot. It has accusations and implications, which I would honestly like to just discount and avoid. I'd like to ignore this passage completely, but I can't. I can't. It points a searching finger at me, and at you, at us, and we have to reckon with it. We have to deal with it. We have to ask ourselves some hard and serious questions. Are we Christians? Are we followers of Christ? If you claim to be a Christian, and I hope you do, then the question is, how are you living your Christian life? What does that look like? What is the essence of your Christian commitments? I want us to really think seriously about this. How are we living our life as a Christian? And are we truly followers of Jesus Christ? You see, I believe the Word of God teaches that the Christian life revolves around two key aspects. Two key aspects. Not the only aspects, but two key aspects. The first pivotal point of our Christian life is our spiritual faith. It's a matter of faith. In order to be a true follower of Jesus Christ, we must trust Christ explicitly for our salvation. See, we're Christians by faith. This is the one non-negotiable, unchangeable, ever-constant foundation of Christianity. We must confess our sins. We need to turn away from our sins and accept Christ into our lives as our personal Savior by faith. It's a faith commitment that we make. Ephesians 2:8 is the verse that we usually think about when we're talking about being saved by faith. Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8, "For it is by grace you've been saved through faith. Therefore, in order to be a true Christian, you must have faith that, one, Jesus died for you, two, that he has forgiven you of your sins, and three, that he will give you salvation." This is a faith commitment we make. It's a matter of faith, complete trust and faith in Jesus Christ alone. Now, this is obviously a very personal and internalized decision. True faith in Jesus Christ for salvation is an issue that is actually a very personal issue between God and each individual person. No one else can give you that faith. In many ways, no one else can actually even regulate that faith. No one else can lend you more faith. No one else can truly look and see the depth and the strength and the sincerity of your faith in Jesus Christ. Only you and God, no one else. I'm convinced that probably without exception, every one of us here today is aware of this truth. Salvation by faith is a uniquely personal, it's a uniquely internal decision. It's a matter that is decisively known only to you and God when you finally get down to it. But here's where difficulty arises many times within our spiritual lives. Here's a point where sometimes frustration can often tempt us. You see, it's possible for a person to claim faith in Jesus Christ without actually having faith in Jesus Christ. Due to the fact that faith is a personal and individual decision, there are some people who believe and act as if they can claim faith without actually having faith. I think that most of us are well familiar with this truth. We see it around us. Sometimes we see it much too much around us. Time and time again, we hear of people, and we see people, and we know people who are very adamant, very quick to claim faith to be Christians. But when you look a little bit closer, they really seem to have no knowledge of what that really means. They have no concept what it means to have faith and trust explicitly and only in Christ. In America, we run into this quite often, although it seems less often now than it used to be. I think that America finds itself in a somewhat downward spiraling process of acquiring a more and more secular and paganistic outlook to life, where it's just about me and my pleasure and my good times, and nothing else matters. And so, despite this fact, America has typically identified itself as a Christian nation, a nation where there are Christian people. And there are certainly many Christians that are still in America. And yet, many times, there are people who believe that they're Christians and that they can claim to be a Christian simply because they grew up in America, a country that is typically and traditionally a Christian nation. And yet, that's not the way the Christian faith works at all. When I was pastoring in California, this was quite a number of years ago, and so I know things change on these types of things, but one of the ways I was trying to reach out to our community is to get to know the people and to try to help myself do that. I did kind of a door-to-door survey, just to kind of find out who the people were and you know, their backgrounds and what was going on in their lives. I asked if I could pray with them. But one of the questions I asked them in the survey, I asked them, "Do you consider yourself to be a Christian?" And then, regardless of what they'd ask, I'd ask them why or why not. And it amazed me, now this is about 30 years ago, okay, so I think the results will be a little bit different today, but I was amazed that so many of the people in the neighborhood said, "Yes, I'm a Christian." But many of them would go on to talk about the fact that they were Christians because they're Americans, as if those two terms are synonymous. I'm an American, I'm a Christian. One lady explicitly said, "Well, I'm an American, so I guess that means I'm a Christian. In a survey that was given by, it was taken by George Barna around that time, then he found that 80% of Americans at that time surveyed and claimed that they were Christians. There's a more recent survey from Barna where that's only about 40% today. But at that time, 80%. And even with 40%, one of the questions that comes up in my mind is, where are these Christians then within our society? Where are they? As true believers, I think that we can often find ourselves frustrated by the fact that many people claim to be a Christian, they claim to be a follower of Christ, but you really don't see that in anything they do, or in their behavior, or the kind of language they use. There's even another problem, which I think is perhaps even a greater threat and sometimes a frustration to our spiritual lives. Some people inwardly reject Christ out of their selfish will to maintain control. And so they say they follow Christ, but they're not going to let him control anything because they don't like that. They want to be in control of what's going on. And yet they continue to publicly claim they're Christians. So I'm going to live my life in my terms, the way I want to. No one's going to tell me anything, but I'm a Christian. And so actually they live very self-centered and egotistical lives. And then, as it were, challenge anyone to disprove their inward and personal faith in Jesus. Because I trust, I believe in Jesus. Well, what does that mean? Well, as Christians, we can often find ourselves tempted to judge these kind of people, right? We judge them. We're tempted to resent them. And sometimes even express hostility towards them. But when we do that, as Jesus himself warned us, then our own faith suffers in that process. As soon as you start pointing a finger at other people and judging them, then your own spiritual life is going to suffer underneath that. Because then your focus isn't upon what God wants you to do, you're judging other people, what they're doing. And that never works out well. The fact of the matter is this, however. A verbal claim of faith in Christ is not necessarily a proof of faith in Christ. Let me say that again. A verbal claim of faith in Christ is not necessarily a proof of faith in Christ. Just because we claim that we have faith in Jesus Christ doesn't mean that we actually have faith in Jesus Christ, that we're living actually a Christ-like life. This is the situation that we find in essence in Jeremiah chapter 5. Now once again, this is pre-Christian times. So we're talking about followers of God, not followers of Jesus, because he had not yet come. But once again, in essence, we find the same type of thing. In verse 2, we read that the people of Jeremiah's time were swearing, as surely as the Lord lives, as surely as the Lord lives. This was a way of them actually expressing faith and trusting God in their lives. As surely as the Lord lives, he's the guide of my life. These words were a claim to faith of these people. These words were a verbal indication on their part of their faith, of their trust, of their dependence upon God alone. Thus, by their words, by their verbal claims, the people claim to be faithful. We are following God. We are doing what God wants us to do. We trust God. And in essence, they dared anyone to disprove the reality of their personal and inward commitment. But verse 2 concludes that by saying, although they say, as surely as the Lord lives, still they are swearing falsely. They're swearing falsely. The idea that Jeremiah points out to us is the same fact we've just identified. Namely, a verbal claim of faith is not necessarily proof that we're trusting and following Jesus. As I already mentioned, the Word of God teaches that the Christian faith revolves around two key aspects. The first aspect is just what we've been talking about. The first aspect is spiritual faith. It's an aspect which is personal and individual and private in nature. It's something that ultimately is truly only known by God and by you yourself. We know this aspect. This is part of Christianity, which is usually most strongly stressed, I've discovered. And rightfully so, for it's by faith that we are saved. But the second aspect of the Christian faith is also extremely important, and it goes hand in hand with faith. The second key aspect around which our Christian faith revolves is actually our life. It's actually our behavior, our lifestyle. It has to do with how we live. You see, the interesting thing here in Jeremiah is that Jeremiah had no problem finding someone who claimed faith in God. This wasn't the problem. Jeremiah had no difficulty in gathering a group of people who would swear allegiance and dependence upon God, as surely as the Lord lives. He found lots of people doing this. He found people all over Jerusalem who were willing to say, as surely as the Lord lives, I follow him. But Jeremiah looked in vain for even one person who dealt honestly and who sought the truth. How tragic is that? And so Jeremiah brings a very difficult truth before us. Friends, Jeremiah teaches us that if we say that we believe in Christ, but we do not live like Christ, then we're not telling the truth. Actually, we're lying about it. We're saying one thing, we're doing something else. And it makes me realize that God is not looking for a people who will just claim to have faith in Christ. Rather, God is looking for a people who are willing to live like Christ. People who actually live life that follow Christ. We need to understand that either our lifestyle will be affected by our faith, or our faith will be affected by our lifestyle. Did you hear that? Either our lifestyle will be affected by our faith, or our faith is going to be affected by our lifestyle. Jeremiah is telling us that we need to realize that either our lifestyle is reflecting our faith, or it's reflecting a lack of faith in the life we live. Our faith and our lifestyle, they go hand in hand. They're actually a mirror of each other. Whether we like that or not, they actually mirror each other. What we say and how we live, the way we live, actually determines the truth of what we say. And so the fact is matter of the matter is that we must live out our faith. It's not enough to simply live out our faith in our words alone, of saying the right things at the right time, of just going through the motions of doing that, but we have to live out our faith in our actions, in our lifestyles. This is the truth that James was trying to remind us in his letter in the New Testament. James wrote, "What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if a person claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such a faith save him? No, James says, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by actions, is dead." In other words, it helps nothing. It proves nothing. It is virtually meaningless unless our lives reflect that faith. This is what James, the brother of Jesus, tells us in his letter. So what did God send Jeremiah to look for in the streets of Jerusalem? We read in Jeremiah chapter 5 that he sent Jeremiah to look for someone who dealt honestly. I have a question I need to ask us. I need to ask myself this morning. It's a pretty easy question to ask, but an uncomfortable question to answer sometimes. The question is, would Jeremiah have found you? Would Jeremiah have found you? Would he have found me in his search? It raises the question, how do you live your life outside of the church? How do you conduct your business? How do you deal with your neighbors? What characterizes your actions with your family, with your friends, with the people you work with your competitors? You see, our actions and lifestyle are not a secondary issue in our spiritual lives. Our actions are a primary issue. Do you have faith in Christ? Well, don't tell me about it. Why don't you show me? Why don't you show me with your actions? Why don't you show me with your attitudes? Why don't you show me with your words of encouragement, with your friendliness, with your godliness, with your righteous and upright behavior, regardless of the circumstance in which you find yourself. Show your neighbors, show your family members, show Jeremiah. Don't tell him. He's heard the words already. We have to show him. You see, I just believe strongly that God is still looking for people who will deal honestly. God is still looking for people who will take the right stand, even if it's an unpopular stand, or even if it's not financially beneficial to us. You see, Christ took that stand. Christ lived this kind of life. And he calls each one of us to live the same kind of life. He calls us to live a life of faith, filled with honesty and integrity in our behavior, not just in our words, but in our behavior. Jeremiah also looked for a person who would seek the truth. He and I discovered a search for truth is sometimes painful. Sometimes the truth hurts. But we cannot have Christ in our lives unless we also seek truth in our lives. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." Jesus is the truth. This means that he cannot tolerate untruth within his body. He cannot tolerate the lack of truth in me or in you. Why? Because Jesus is in truth. He's the truth. If he lives in us, how can there be falsehood in the midst of us as well? I don't try to do this very often anymore. But have you ever tried praying while you're doing something wrong? One of the ways I try not to do things wrong, that helps in that. But if you try praying when you're doing something wrong, you'll find it's just impossible. It's impossible. You can't do it because Jesus is the truth. Seeking truth also means that we seek what is right. If we recognize a situation or predicament which is wrong, but we do nothing to correct it, then we're not seeking the truth. Matter of fact, we're living in a lie at that point. We're not seeking that which is right. You know, there's a situation that I went through about 6-7 months ago, which I'm sometimes hesitant about this because sometimes these were pastors would get up and act as if they do everything right all the time. It's just not true. But sometimes we do, right? We try. But I was grocery shopping at the Walmart neighborhood store just down Academy, a couple blocks from here. And I had a couple items, and I was standing in the checkout line to go out. There's a guy in front of me doing his stuff. It always takes longer when you want to when you're waiting for him, right? And he was, it became obvious he was getting some cash back. That takes some more time, so I'm just waiting in that time. And so he does that, and so he packs up his groceries, and he goes and he walks out the store. And so I come up and put my groceries down and look down, and he'd forgotten his cash. There's $40 in cash hanging out of the register there in front of me. $40. He's outside the store. Well, I grabbed that money, left my stuff behind, and I ran outside the store. And I caught him just as he was getting in the car, saying, hey, your money, you forgot it. Oh, I can't believe I did that. Thank you so much. I went back inside the store. And as I was coming out, then there was one of my former students who was coming into the store. And he said, "You and I just heard, someone just heard me, someone left $40 back, and someone ran down and gave it to them." He looked at me and he said, "That was you, wasn't it? That was you, wasn't it, Dr. Powers?" I said, "Yeah." He said, I should have known. I wish I always get it right. I don't. You might think, "Hey, Dan, that was nice of you, but that really doesn't have anything to do with my faith, your faith in Christ. That really has nothing to do with my Christianity." It doesn't? It doesn't? I think our faith in Christ should change the way we deal with other people. Our faith in Christ doesn't just change the way we communicate with God. It has to change the way we deal with other people as well, if it's true faith. Christianity is not only an inward experience, it's an outward experience that we express in the way we live our lives. It should change the way we live our lives that reflect that of Christ. Do you think if Christ was in that grocery store, he just would have pocketed that $40 and walked along his way? Absolutely not. So how could I dare do anything different if I say I'm following after Christ? This is the issue we face here. Here's one of the amazing things that we can see from this story in Jeremiah. Just think about this for a moment. Do you realize that God and Jeremiah actually expected to recognize a true follower of God by his or her actions? Jeremiah expected to see it, to recognize it. Not just hear someone claim it, but actually see it in the way that people live their lives. I wonder, when people look at me, can they see a person who's a Christian? When a person looks at you, can they see that you're a Christian in a positive way? Was your life just like the life of everyone else? I'm no different, I'm just forgiven. Baloney on that. That's not true. I don't believe that. If your life's no different than anyone else, you're not forgiven because you've not repented. I don't believe that statement. Our lives are going to reflect that. Doesn't mean we never make mistakes, but our life is a life living after Christ. It needs to be different. Until we begin to act out our verbal claims to faith, until we actually start to live the way we say we live, I don't think we'll truly be able to find God. And worse yet, God will not be able to truly find us. Our Christian life revolves around a faith and a lifestyle. It's a lifestyle that is compared and modeled with Christ himself. And I'm convinced that we will not be able to have true spiritual victory until we yield both parts of our life to God, our inward spirit and will, and our outward lifestyle and behavior. You see, God wants all of us. That's the basic idea. God wants all of us. He doesn't just want the Sunday part, or the Sunday school part, or the worship service part. I love this part, but he wants more than this from us. He wants every part of us, every bit of us, all of it. There's one other element that we must not miss from Jeremiah chapter 5 that I think is very significant. So far we've talked about our own personal lives and what we must believe and do in order to be truly saved. And as we've seen, in order to experience the fullness of God's mercy and the fullness of God's glory in our lives, we must have faith in the Lord Jesus Christ for forgiveness and salvation. But we also need to live out that faith in our daily behavior, in the way we live our lives. But Jeremiah's experience brings in another element for us as well. The fact of the matter is, the way we live our lives affects other people too. It affects other people in addition to ourselves. Do you realize that the way you live your Christian life will play a major role, not an insignificant role, it'll play a major role in whether or not the people around you will accept Christ in their lives or will actually reject Christ in their lives? The way we live our lives not only affects our own life, but it affects the lives of all the people around us as well. Listen to God's words to Jeremiah we read this morning. If you find but one person who deals honestly and seeks the truth, I will forgive this city. Let me quickly remind you what the historical context here is. Jeremiah is ministering just before historically we know that the kingdom falls and the people are placed into exile. God says, if you find but one person who deals honestly and seeks the truth, I will forgive this city. The disaster, the tragedy could have been avoided if but one person would have been found faithful, who would have sought the truth, who would deal honestly. All the destruction, the exile, the pain, the death of the city of Jerusalem could have been prevented if we can trust the word of God, if but one person had lived the life they claimed they were living. Isn't this incredible? All of that kind of destruction could have been prevented by the honest and truthful living of just one person. And the question comes back to us again. Would Jeremiah have found me? Would Jeremiah have found you? Or we just would have been in this line of, oh, I believe in Jesus. Oh, as surely as the Lord lives, then I just do my own thing as I walk out of the room. We need to rouse ourselves out of this kind of spiritual slumber. We need to stop our wrongful thinking that our Christian life is just my business and no one else's. Because that's not true. We don't live alone. The picture your life paints of Jesus Christ is either drawing people towards Christ or pushing people away from Christ. And so the question comes again, would Jeremiah find me? Would he find you? Is your life saving our city, or is your life destroying our city? Only you and I can decide that, with God's help. You understand why this is kind of a hard passage for me to preach from? It makes me really uncomfortable. Sorry, it makes you probably pretty uncomfortable too. But this passage in Jeremiah haunts me. It points a finger at me that I don't like to admit, that I don't like to face up to. But I can't avoid it, and neither can you. Christ calls us to a faith and to a lifestyle. Your life can make the difference. Your smile, your good attitude, your helping hands could make a difference between the acceptance or rejection of Christ by the people around you. Your friendship and integrity could be the difference between salvation and rejection. Your concern and hospitality could be the last straw for victory in a person's life, or the last straw for utter defeat and failure in their life spiritually. And of course, your own life depends upon your decision as well. A verbally claimed faith without action is no good. Your eternal destiny depends upon not only a claim of faith, but the authenticity of a lifestyle of living after Christ. But the truly important thing here is that it's not only your life that's at stake, it's the life and eternal destiny of those who are around you as well. Your children, your grandchildren, your family, your friends, your colleagues, their future depends upon you as well. The words of Jeremiah speak to us once again today. The Lord says, go up and down the streets of Jerusalem. Go up and down the streets of Colorado Springs. Go up and down the streets of Academy. Look around and consider. Search through her squares. If you can find but one person who deals honestly and seeks the truth, I will forgive this city. The destiny of this city, of our families, of our church, of our children, of our friends at stake. Would Jeremiah find you? Would Jeremiah find me? With God's help, with His Spirit, He can find us as we live the lives that God has called us to, faithfulness and obedience to Christ. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, I thank you for the forgiveness that you offer us in Jesus Christ. I thank you that when we repent of our sins, that indeed you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to save us, give us eternal life. Father, this is the most important decision we can make. It's a decision that actually casts the die for the direction in which we will live our life, the way we will face the end of our life. But Lord, sometimes I think when we get into the midst of this kind of thing, we recognize this is a keenly personal, individual decision. It's easy for us to kind of just get in the habit of mouthing the words, of saying the right things, of saying, oh, Jesus, forgive me, and then we go about our business as if nothing has changed. And we don't allow your Spirit to truly change our lives. Father, I'd ask that in these moments right now that you would speak to us in a special way, that you would ask us the question, do our lives actually reflect the faith that we so often claim? Do we live a life that actually reflects and models the life of Christ Himself? Am I allowing the Spirit to guide me and direct me in my attitudes towards other people, in my actions towards them, and the way that the demeanor in my face is, and the way I just go about my business? Is this reflecting Christ? Is it reflecting something inside myself which is not Christ-like at all? Father, I thank you for the victory we can have through Jesus Christ. I thank you that forgiveness is true, that it is real. I thank you that the Spirit has been poured out upon us to make this difference in our life. But Father, we need to live in step with that Spirit. It's so easy to fall back into the pattern of the world. Everyone else is doing it. It seems like the popular thing to do, regardless of what that is. And our focus on Christ sometimes begins to fade. And then we're looking at the world around us for the markers and for the pace we should be going instead of looking to Christ. Father, these are one of these sermons that I think is very important. Not very comfortable, but it's very important for us to allow you to search our hearts, to know our thoughts, to work within our lives, and that we can say, Father, here's my life. It's not just my words. It needs to be in my actions. It needs to be in my attitudes. Father, needs to penetrate to the very depths of my soul that actually reflects in the behavior I have during the week. Father, would you do that work within us? I thank you so much, Lord, for your faithfulness in that process. I thank you for your patience in that process. And yet, Father, we do need to live lives that reflect you and bring glory to your name. And so, Father, we leave this place. As we go back to the business of this day and this coming week, I would ask that you allow the presence of Christ to settle upon us. That it be something that is so internally interwoven into our will, into our being, that Christ guides us in what we say and what we think and what we do, and the attitudes we display, and the things that we're looking at in television, the kind of books we're reading, the kind of conversations we enter into. The Father, we would allow Christ to reflect into everything that's going on in our lives, because this is what it truly means to be a Christian, to be like Christ, to follow after him. Thank you, Father, for the victory that could be ours. I thank you for this faith you've given to us that changes not only the way we think, but changes the way we live, changes the things we do. And in all these things, Father, the praise and glory go to you alone. And so I pray your blessing upon these people, Father, as they go into this week, whether they're here or online. Would you guide and direct them? Would you allow people to be able to see Christ in each one of us? And when we find those things in our life that do not reflect Christ, Father, would you help us to repent of that, to confess that, allow your Spirit to cleanse that from us so we can truly be the people that we say we are, that you've called us to be, your glory. And so we go with your presence, we go with your peace, we go with your promise, Father, and we give you thanks and praise. These things we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. The Lord bless you and live a life that honors Christ this week. Amen.